to the Gospel of Luke, the second chapter. I don't know if you know this, but black widows, after they mate, the female kills the male. I guess that's something to die for, but some wild animals kill their young if they find a blemish in them. God gives us 12 years to love our children before they become teenagers. If kids were born as teenagers, we might just do what wild animals do before we have a chance to get to love them. You've probably discovered that it's easier to be a teenager than it is to be a teenager's parents. Can I get an amen for that? I know you all think, oh, what's the big deal? I'm easy to raise up. That's the problem. We're all aware that it's a tough world out there, but if you're under the age of 18, enjoy your time at home. You may be under the impression that the early years are free, but it's costing someone dearly for those early years, and you better be aware of who the landlord is. The problem with teenagers is that they're half kid and half adult. So they think half the time like a kid, and half the time they think like an adult. And the problem with that is that half the adults nowadays think like children. What's funny, when you're raising kids, as they get into those teenage years, and, you know, you'll tell them what they need to do and the chores, at least we did, and they'll come back at you like this: "Don't you tell me what to do. Who do you think you are?" Then half an hour later, they're looking at you and they're crying, "I don't know what to do. What should I do?" They're just confused, you know, half kid, half adult. I heard of an 18-year-old young man who said to his parents, "No one's going to tell me what to do. You'll see. I'm going to go and join the Marines." My mom and dad once had a sit-down talk with my brother. He had some problems with my dad's hair coat. And Daniel, my dad said to my brother, "Daniel, if you don't cut any classes, get straight A's and B's, and keep your hair cut, I'll buy you a new used car. Whatever you'd like, up to a certain amount of money, I'll buy you a new car. Used car, but a new one." So Dan was great because he was a little bit tough on his vehicles. So, you know, it was easy for him to get straight A's. It was just really easy for Dan to get straight A's. He didn't cut any classes. And he came to my dad and he said, "All right, Dad, I've not cut any classes. I've got straight A's. You've seen the report card now 2 semesters. I want my new car. Where's my new car?" And my dad said, "Dan, the 3 stipulations were you get straight A's, no cutting classes, and you keep and get your hair cut. You still haven't cut your hair." And Dan said, "Jesus had long hair." And my mother looked at my brother and said, "And that's exactly why Jesus didn't have a car." I thought about that, and I'm like, man, my mom is smart. Wow, she's always got an answer. In Luke chapter 2, I know that you've heard the Christmas story about how Jesus came, the God-man came as a boy. And then you read about his early years and all that. Now you get to chapter 2, verse 42, verse 41, if you would. Stand with me as I read you this passage of scripture. Can you imagine? Can you just imagine? His parents went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of the Passover. Now, all men 25 years of age and younger had to go and needed to go once in their lifetime. And it was a great time for parents to teach a visual aid to their sons of the Passover meal. And it's really much better to do it when you go to Jerusalem and you go to the temple. And so they did this, though, not once in Jesus' lifetime. They did this every year. His parents went to Jerusalem every year at the Feast of the Passover. And when he was 12 years old, they went up to Jerusalem according to the custom of the feast. When they had finished the days, as they returned, the boy Jesus lingered behind in Jerusalem. He wasn't yet a teenager, but he was already thinking like one, wasn't he? And Joseph and his mother did not know it, but supposing him to have been in the company, they went a day's journey and sought him among their relatives and acquaintances. So when they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem seeking him. Now, so it was that after 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the teachers, both listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were astonished at his understanding and answers. So when they saw him, they were amazed. And his mother said to him, "Son, why have you done this to us? Look, your father and I have sought you anxiously." He said unto them, "Why did you seek me? Did you not know that I must be about my father's business?" And in some translations it says, "Why didn't you know that I would be here in my father's house?" Both are fine, but you have to understand in the original, he really meant, of course I'm going to be here. Where else would I be? And about my father's business. So then he went on, but they did not understand the statement which he spoke to them. Then he went down with them and came to Nazareth, and he was subjected to them. But his mother kept all these things in her heart, and Jesus increased in wisdom and stature, in favor with God and with men. And that's what we should be doing. God, I pray that these points, Lord, would fall not on deaf ears, but open ears and hearts ready to receive. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Every year, Joseph and Mary took this yearly pilgrimage to Jerusalem. Mary knew. Mary and Joseph both had been told. But it's kind of like you and me when we make a decision at the altar and we fall in love with the Lord and we commit and surrender our lives to him. And then the further we get away from that moment, let's remember, in all ways he was human, but yet still God. So he was a boy, and she would have had to change his dirty clothes because, like you and me, he was a human being. And wrapped up in parenting both Joseph and Mary, at the age of 12, they took him with a large company of family, and the women and the children would gone on ahead, and then the men would trail behind. And they got to Jerusalem. They went through the 7 or 8 days of Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread, and then they made their way back. And they thought they had their son with them, but you know, the women and children go on ahead, and there's lots of kids, and in this group, this posse, this group of family members going, you just knew someone had, well, everyone would have been accounted for. And they didn't do a head count, so they get a day away, probably about at supper time, when they're closing down, going 20 to 25 miles in a day, and they stop for the evening, and now all the parents are saying it's time to wash up, it's time to get ready for dinner, and they can't find Jesus. Mary had lost the Son of God. And boy, I mean, that's kind of funny, but at the same time, it's kind of not, because what do you do when you've lost God and the Son of God? Don't you know, though, that Mary and Joseph were troubled after they discovered that Jesus was not with the family pilgrimage and the group? The King James Version said they were wrought. I'd be wrought, too, if I'd lost God. There's three questions that you need to ask and answer yourself about this simple, funny, humorous passage. There's three questions. The first one is, have you ever lost the Son of God? And I believe the answer is every single one of us have lost the Son of God. At some point in our lives, we have been in a state of lostness. in heaven, there's only two sets of people that the Lord will judge at the three or four different judgments, and that's the lost and the saved. That's it. You're not going to be separated by what you think or by what you think your pedigree or your family setting is, or rather by your good works. There's lots of ways people think they can gain glory, but according to Jesus, there's only one: either being saved by him or you're in a state of lostness. But then all we like sheep, Isaiah said in 53, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have each wandered away from him, and we and our sins have been placed upon Jesus Christ. All of us have been in a state of lost. Have you ever found Jesus? He's seeking after people today. He's seeking after you. Some events might have unfolded this week in your life that point to a trial or a triumph in your life. And those different intervals or their crisis of belief will fall and cause you either to come to Christ and be saved or to run from Christ and stay in a state of lostness. Now, some churches and some faith practices teach that after you're saved, because of the letter of Jude and 2 Peter, that our Bible teaches us that you can be saved and then you can lose your salvation. Baptists believe that's not true, and here's the reason why. Not because we're Baptists, but rather because we traditionally have called ourselves Biblicists, people who follow the Bible. This is what Southern Baptists, specific by creed and by statement, believe: that the Bible is the sole and only guide for life and living. That means this: you can't trust the church. You can't trust the traditions of the church. It's not because we're Baptists or Southern Baptists that makes us good or makes us saved. It's not the Baptist faith and message of 1963 or of the year 2000. That's a creed, a document, a confessional that our missionaries and our pastors agree with, but it's only because it points back and it points to the Word of God and says, this is the book that is the sole and only guide for life and living. And if you don't go by just the Bible, you're going to be in trouble, and here's the reason why. Every church, every faith practice has different traditions that they get in the rut or in the comforts of following, and they kind of get lost in their traditions. People don't know what they believe and why they believe it. They're just doing what their mom and dad, their grandparents did, and they can't explain. You probably can't explain lots of things that we do: why we partake of the Lord's Supper, how we partake of the Lord's Supper, why you were baptized. You don't know why you were dunked, or why you were sprinkled or just touched with the crucifix of a priest. You don't know why. You just trust that someone's teaching you right. But this is what I'm saying to you. You need to stop that. The only thing that you and I should trust with all of our hearts and all of our lives is the Word of God. It's truth without any mixture of error. So instead of following a church practice or a preacher, a priest, a faith tradition, you go back to the Word of God. Why do we believe that you can't lose your salvation? You say, well, I've read the book of Jude, the letter. I've read 2 Peter. And apparently some people who profess something, they didn't possess something, and they fell away from the faith. And it's not because they were saved and then they got lost. It's because they never were saved in the first place. They might have said a prayer. They might have believed in a confession. They might have done and followed the trendy time to go and do what another friend or what their spouse had done or wanted. So they did it to please someone else, or they didn't understand and they were just doing it. And maybe that's you today. You've never followed through. You've never figured out your doubts. But it's a big church, and you really don't want to go down front and talk to the pastor or another staff member because, well, people will talk about you. I remember years ago when Gina first started teaching Sunday school class, it was their senior adult ladies class, about 40 ladies. And one Sunday, the Lord led her just to forego the Sunday school lesson, the curriculum, and she really felt led of the Lord to give the plan of salvation and how she got saved. So she told them, and man, three ladies raised their hand, all in their 80s. They came down crying after class was over. They were good friends. And they told Gina what they needed to do. And she stayed back with them and she walked them through the sinner's prayer. And at the end of that, they said to Gina, please, when you tell Dr. Anthony, please tell him not to announce this in church. And she said, oh no, we need to celebrate this and come down front in the invitation time. We need other people in our church probably feel the same way. Oh no, we're not going to do that. We've been in this church so long that people will mock us and they'll talk about us and it won't be good. And some of them had husbands that would get upset with them, they thought. Isn't that a shame? And I know that there's people here today, here this morning, that might think the same. You won't figure it out or you won't find out because you're so caught up in the audience instead of pleasing the audience of just one, Christ. You ask him, even right now, I'm doubting. I've doubted for years. You can clear that up and get clarity to that thing. But you can't. Jesus is not an Indian giver. Once he gives you salvation, he doesn't take it back. He didn't give you and grant you salvation based on how good of a person you are in the first place. So if you sin again, you can't lose your faith. Instead of you believing me, may I give you the word of God that will help you with this? 1 John 5:11-13. John wrote, and this is the record that God has given to us eternal life. And this life is in his Son, Jesus Christ. He who has the Son has life. And he who does not have the Son does not have life. These things have I written unto you, this testimony have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may, listen, know that you have eternal life. Not that you may think, not that you may feel saved, but you may know that you have eternal life. He wants you and I to know it. And then he said this in John 10:27-30. My sheep, they hear my voice and they know me. And I know them, and they follow me. And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No man is able to pluck them out of my hand. My Father who gave them all to me is greater than all. No man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. You didn't get salvation by saying, I want it, name it, claim it. No, you received your salvation because it was a gift of God. Ephesians 2:8-9. Say it with me. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. He gave it to you as a gift. Is God a liar? Can he give you something and then take it back? No. Jude, verse 24, says, now to him, Jesus Christ, who is able to keep you or to preserve you, to seal you, and to present you faultless before God the Father. Man, he's not only going to keep you, preserve you. You say, well, what happened there in Jude and 2 Peter? These people did the trendy thing. They professed something with their mouth, but they didn't possess it in their heart. They never were changed. And in our day and age, there's a lot of people that get insurance of heaven. They do. They want their one way out of hell pass free at the cost of Christ. So they get saved, but they return right back to their former lifestyle. They never have a love affair with Christ. It's a one-nighter. And they just leave him at the altar. They go right back to their lifestyle and they think, well, I can do anything. Now I've got the grace to sin. Paul addressed this in his book where he said, what shall we sin then that grace abound? No. He gives us a license not to sins, but to a license from sin. He wants to free you from the chains, the vices, the addictions that's held you. You can't lose Jesus Christ, but let me tell you, all we, like saved sheep, still wander, prone to wandering. We go astray. Have you gone astray? Have you left your first love? Like Jesus said to that last church there in Revelation, have you left your first love? You need to return to the former things and start doing what you did, the fundamentals, the basics that you did right from the beginning. So, like Mary and Joseph, have you lost Jesus? If you've never been found, if you've never been saved, you need to clear that up today and remove all doubt. And if you've walked away from him as a Christian, and there's not fruit in your life, and there's not been fruit in your life for years, if you're prone to gossip and get critical about others, man, it doesn't take any size to criticize in today's age and in today's church. If you come to church and all you do is see nitpicky reasons why not to come, that's not a sign that you are saved. If you can't stand a lot of people at church or a few people at church, or if there's someone at church that you hate, in 1 John, John, under the guidance of the Holy Spirit, said, you can't love the child of God and not have the love of God in you. You can't say that you love the commandments and the word of God and not keep the commandments. I'm not saying you're under the law. We're free from it, but we're still under the principles and the spirit of the law and the Holy Spirit who gives us the license from the law not to have to be bound by it, but to be above it and walk and overcome it. Have you lost the Son of God? Is your love relationship with Christ the way it was the day you got saved, or has it fizzled out? Are you just sputtering along on four cylinders when you've got a six-cylinder spiritual engine? Is there a problem? Trust me, it's not him. You need to return to the point of departure and find out where you left him and you got on another throne. So have you lost the Son of God? Secondly, have you submitted yourself to the Heavenly Father? Go back with me to verse 49 of this text. And he said to his parents, why did you seek me? Did you not know that I must be about my Father's business? Jesus said, I must be about my Father's business. If you would, look with me back in John chapter 14. What is the business of God the Father? I wish I had time to give you one illustration that talks about the first century wedding, but for the sake of time, I mean, it's a wonderful illustration of how all the Jews in the first century would know full well what Jesus meant when he was preaching here in John chapter 14. When he said, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, the Father. Believe also in me. For in my Father's house or in his mansion, there are many rooms or many mansions. If I go to him, I will come back and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you will be also. And this was a promise, a pledge, a covenant that he made to his children because they were troubled. They were upset, they were discomforted because they thought he was leaving them when he talked about leaving his Holy Spirit behind to give them courage, to enable them, to empower them, to convict them against sin and to righteousness, all the things that the Holy Spirit would do. And then he said this, greater things you'll do in my name than even I have done. Have you been doing that? What? Jesus, of course, when he stayed back from going with Mary and his earthly father, Joseph, of course they would find Jesus, the Son of God, in the temple. It was home. Amen. Did you get that? In my Father's house, he taught, are many mansions. The earthly temple of the Lord was a picture of the eternal home that God will bring down from heaven on earth one day. And the thousand-year reign of Christ, if you know anything about end-time prophecy, the thousand-year reign of Christ, the home of the Lord Jesus Christ, the temple will be reestablished, and Jesus Christ will sit on his throne. Listen to me now. There'll be no more hospitals. During the thousand-year reign of Christ, there's no more police. There's no more problems like we have today. There's just people. And you say, people with no problems? That's an anomaly. That doesn't happen. That's true. But here's the reason why. The Lord reigns. The Lord reigns, and he reigns in righteousness. He rules this time not as a servant, but as Savior and King. That's crazy. It's a different place. Why? Because heaven has come down and the Lord reigns on earth. 1,000 years he will reign. Why? And what is he doing when he was a 12-year-old boy? Well, if you know anything about Jewish rites, for 12 years the parents would, like a sponge, soak up their son and their daughter in the teaching of the Torah. And they would make a boy from the age he was 4 to 5 read Leviticus over and over and over and over again. And they would have to memorize large portions like Deuteronomy 6, the Shema, which they were to establish on their frontlets, on their wrist, all of these oracles and mandates and teachings of God. Why? Because the parents wish for the next generation to be as strong, if not stronger, than the current generation. Because people are prone to wander, and sometimes we kind of forget the past and we go to our own traditions, and they wanted them to have right out of God's law what they should do. So they were teaching them this. And then when a boy gets around 12 years old as a Jew, they would take him into the temple, and if he had the scruples enough to understand it, they would show them by visual aids what the Lord did when he passed over, the Passover angel. They'd tell all the stories. Well, man, they left and Jesus wasn't with them. Where was he? Well, he was back in his father's house at home, and he was sitting down in the porch area, the patio, with the teachers of the law. And not only would he ask questions, but when they asked him questions, they were astonished at his ability to answer. Why? Because he was doing his father's business. What is the father's business? I am constantly amazed with how many Christians today think that by going to church once a week, twice a week, three times a week, that's the father's business. We don't live our lives so that we can go to church and check it off that we've done the right thing. Faithful is going to church, tithing, talents, treasures, all of that. But what's wrong with living for the Lord every day? What is your calling? No matter what job, I'm not the only person here in this room called. The ministers, the missionaries in this room, they're not the only people who are called. Everyone is called. Jesus said, all are called. Few will follow. The fields are white unto harvest, but there are some of us that just keep making excuses for not being about the Father's business. Everything you do, not when the choir sings, not when the band plays, not when other people are doing special, that's not worship. Worship is not what you do when you come to church. Worship is every act that you ascribe value to God the Father. Are you giving value to God the Father by everything that you and I do every part of the day? You should worship him every day, and whatever you do, in word and deed, what all you do, everything should be done to the glory of God. Every act, every word should be an act, a word of worship. It brings value to the Lord Jesus Christ. That is the Father's business. And you and I are failures when it comes to sin. We've sinned, but when we walk in the power and the might of the Holy Spirit, he convicts us of sin, we get it right, we restore the fellowship, and we go on. And that's a wonderful walk with God. Job had that kind of a walk with God. The early David had that kind of a walk with God. Joseph had that kind of a walk with God. Enoch had that kind of a walk with God. He walked with God and then he was no more. Why? Because he walked with God. Are you walking with God? Are you about your Father's business? What is your Father's business? What is your purpose here? He's put you here on planet Earth, in Anniston, in Jacksonville, wherever you live, he's put you here for a purpose and a reason. And he wants you to fulfill that plan and that purpose and do the will of the Father. Everything that Jesus did when he was here and alive on earth was for the Father's business. And he was the picture for you and me of the Father's business. Are you about your Father's business? And then the third question, are you subject to your earthly parents? Are you subject to your earthly parents? Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and your mother, which is the first commandment with promise. What did it mean? All of the other commandments have promise, but this was the first one that was ushered back in the Old Testament with a promise. In other words, if you do this, long life shall be added unto you. You say, well, I know a man, I know a woman that really honored their parents, and yet they died young. Well, if they were a believer, they'll have long life in the life to come. And boy, that's the life that really, really matters. This is the first commandment with promise. Watch this, that it may be well with you and you may live long on the earth. Now, here's how I know that television 20, 40 years ago had it right more biblically than most of the writers now. Because remember on Star Trek, you got this guy, I can't even do it with my hand, but he would always say, live long and prosper. And he had pointed ears. You know why? Because they were pointed up to heaven. I'm just kidding with you about that one. I mean, if they were pointed downward, you would have known Spock's from a bad place, but they were pointed upward. Think about this, live long and prosper. Some of us say, how are you? Well, I'm blessed and highly favored. Well, when you say that, if you're going through a trial, someone might look at you and say, you don't seem to be too favored today. No, but I'm favored because I know where I'm headed and I know who's going to take me there. I mean, you are, no matter what, but it's all in a matter of perspective. But then you have this thing that some people think, well, my parents, they're not even saved, and I'm a Christian. I once had a young man who came to my office, and he said this, my parents don't know what they're talking about. And I just looked at him, and I said, I see it runs in the family. Because everything that he taught, he had a reason not to follow, not to submit, not to subject himself. And there's a lot of people in today's age like this. There's a reason, there's an excuse. They're not going to submit because they don't like the word authority and submit. And you got to admit, in America today, we've been taught the whole premise from school on up is you can do whatever you want and have it your way. I read this week with great anxiety this professor at Fresno State who had nothing but negatives and curse words about Barbara Bush's passing. And she doesn't think she can be fired. And the only thing that's going to get that poor, dear, depraved soul fired is the fact that donors to the school just write into the president and say, you know, we're not going to pay, we're not going to give as long as she's remaining on staff. That's unfortunate that money and green drives the gravy train. That's very unfortunate. We need to make sure and certain that as Christians, our business does not thrive based on the greenbacks that come in, but rather on the throne that we're trying to please, the audience of one. This lady has said everything and said anything she could to get her 15 minutes of fame, and that's possible on this side. You can say anything, you can write, you can type anything, you can say anything on social media today, and does it please God? Does it glorify God? Does it show that you're subjected to Him and you're subjected to your parents? You might say, like a lot of people have said to me, my parents aren't saved. They're not even good Christians. I mean, they might be Christians, but they're not good Christians. I always take people and kids back to this text. At 12, Jesus had enough bearings to understand, and he knew who he was. He wasn't a Christian, he was the Christian, right? I mean, he was the Christ. And he could have said the excuse, well, I don't have to follow my mom and dad. They're not as good as Christians as I am. That was very true. But he subjected himself. Even after he became a 30-year-old and had his ministry, full knowledgeable that he was God and now on mission as God for the cross, he still subjected himself to his mother. He still was under the authority of his parenting. And Joseph was his stepfather, so you can't use that excuse either. You see, God wants us to honor our father and mother. And this is why it's a commandment with promise, because it will be well with you and with others. You say, well, my parents don't really want me to remain a virgin. They don't want me to remain chaste. They don't think it's that important. My mom and dad smoke pot. My mom and dad smoke. My mom and dad drink. And we use all these excuses to do the things that we want to do. But God is a perfect heavenly father. And he is the watermark. And Jesus Christ, his son, was a perfect example of what kind of a kid you and I should and can be. And he subjected himself to his earthly parents. It will be well with you, and it will be well with others. It really is a question of authority and submittance. It's that third question that's a difficult one to honor and to answer, because it's so difficult in today's age with today's dysfunctional family. We can come up with all kinds of excuses. Why? Well, my stepfather, he allowed me, or he was a part of a molestation in my life. He hurt me. Have you subjected to the Heavenly Father who will give you power to forgive that horrific act in your life? Have you been beat? Have you been abused? Have you been emotionally scarred because of your parents? God can give you freedom and give you forgiveness for them. Even if they're dead in the grave, you can go to the grave. I've helped many people to go to the grave and say, I know you're not asking, but Christ has given me forgiveness for you, and you are forgiven. That just is freeing you up to be a Christian, a Christ-like person, and to subject yourself to those above you that God has placed in authority over you. And he wants you to submit to others. He wants us all to submit to the hierarchy that he's established here on earth: government, marriage, church, all of these hierarchical governing overtures that we have in earth. He wants us to learn, like his son, to submit, like his Holy Spirit, to the Lord Jesus Christ. Subject yourself to your parents. It's a sign or a sense that you're following in the path of Christ. Have you discovered the plan, the purpose, the business of your father? He's in business to get each and every one of us to look more like his son every day. And finally, again, the first question: have you lost the Lord? Have you answered the question about your eternal state of homeness? He is preparing a place for you. Do you doubt whether or not you knew what you were doing, or you know you were just messing around when you made that decision? You need to get clarity in your life there. Remove all confusion. And if you think, as a Christian, you've truly given your heart to Christ, and yet you feel as though you've lost your salvation, you're doubting the word of God, I gave you five passages today that let you know, once you're saved, you're always saved. You might sin still, but God, through the power of his Holy Spirit, is convicting you of righteousness and bringing you back into his fellowship. But you know, I've recognized that faint knock on our door gets softer and softer and softer the more we refuse and we reject his voice in our life. Is he knocking on your heart's door right now? Is he saying, let me in? Or, hey, I want to restore that fellowship. Are you where you need to be? Or like Mary and Joseph, have you lost Jesus along the way? Go back to your point of departure. That's your point of return. And get it right with him. God, I'm praying that